Good morning, San Francisco.
Good morning.
Awesome. It's great to see, well, it's great to see some new faces. It's fantastic to see people from yesterday. My name again is Hi Carol. I'm working with ODSC. Please tweet about us. Take photos of the lovely people around you and like great slides and presenters, and tweet them with the hashtag ODSC. But yeah, anyways, it's fantastic. We had great workshops yesterday, and it was just so great to see everyone so super engaged in them. We're really excited to have people with us this morning for the workshops, and of course the ones this afternoon, and in the next 2 days. Basically, to get stuff started, we want to call up folks from Microsoft. We're just really grateful to be in this Reactor space. Yeah, actually tell us, do people like this space?
Yes.
Don't worry, they'll get warmed up more for getting started. So anyways, this is a great community space where different groups of developers can come in and use the space. We're going to call up a technical evangelist, Gabby from Microsoft, to just tell us a little bit about this space and how you folks can, with your organizations, come up and use the space sometime. So could we have a quick round of applause for Gabby from Microsoft?
Hello, everyone. So this space literally is not even a month old, but like I said, it's open to all developer events. So if you want to come to any of the developer events that we're hosting, we have a calendar available on our website. And also if you want to host your own, you also go to the website and send in a request. It's very easy and it's open to almost anyone as long as we have time in the space for you guys, because it's getting really busy. But welcome, and I hope you really enjoy it. And like I said, it's open to all developer events.
Thank you, Gabby. Thank you, Microsoft. The exit is where you walked in the building. That's the emergency exits over here. The bathrooms are over there by the cubbies. We have some coffee and tea in the back for you. Around lunch, we'll have some sodas, some pizza, but there are also some great options, Chinese food, good deli, a hot dog place across the street. We're in downtown San Francisco. There's lots of great things around as well. So. I think that's most of what we have for announcements this morning. As you know, ODSC conference is November 14th and 15th. We're really excited to see you there. We think almost everybody here is registered for that. If you're not, or if you have any questions about ODSC, talk to Hannah right here. Hannah Clausen can help you with that or help you get your friends or colleagues to register for the conference. We're really excited to have, we'll go for about an hour and a half of this workshop. And then we'll have a break for coffee and such, and then we'll keep going until 12:30. I'd like to welcome Rob Hall. Rob is a instructor in data science at General Assembly. He's, in addition to being a data scientist, he's a product manager. He's built products using data science, and he's gonna talk to us about some of that today, as well as just teaching us in this introduction to machine learning. So please, folks, put your hands together for Rob Hall.
Thanks, hi. First of all, I did a quick sound check, but how's the volume level? Can you guys hear me just fine in the back as well? A little louder? Or?
He's louder.
Louder in the back? Okay. How about that? All right, cool. First of all, I want to thank hi for that introduction. I want to thank the ODSC folks for arranging this and giving me the opportunity to share a little bit of what I know about machine learning. After working with data for a long time, there's a tendency to think in distributions. And so I'm a little bit curious to hear more about the distribution of people's backgrounds here in the room and see what matches and what we see at General Assembly. So just a quick hand raise. So if your background is more computer science, software development, just raise your hand. It's about 10. Okay, cool. If your background is more quantitative and or science. Okay, so 11 or 12. And then, assuming the rest is kind of a mix, which is generally what we see in the General Assembly class. That matches pretty well with what I'm used to do. So one-third kind of more computer science programming background, one-third more quantitative science background, maybe some people may come from a background like product management or business analytics or something else. Okay. So before diving right into machine learning, I want to give a little bit of context. Starting with, who's this guy here on Sunday morning talking about machine learning? As I mentioned, kind of a hybrid of a product manager, product leader, and data scientist. I've built a number of products that had a heavy machine learning and data science component to them. More recently, in the last three and a half years, I really transitioned more into machine learning and data science, including more hands-on development. And in the process, discovered that I really enjoy sharing what I've learned and teaching it. So I'm also a instructor for the data science class at General Assembly. I also help onboard other data science instructors and train them as part of that role. Some of the products I've helped build, you can see up on the screen, include search marketing, a company called Overture that has been acquired by Yahoo, which is Yahoo Search Marketing. Worked on some of the core web search stuff at Yahoo while I was there. Also worked at Yahoo News on news search and some other products that we built on top of news search to do some clustering of related news articles and some local news content pages. Also did some consulting work for another company in the search space that was building a social question and answer app, so you think of Yahoo Answers or Quora. Also worked for a couple of startups, one of which was doing prediction for energy usage as an input to controlling an energy storage system. So actual batteries on-site businesses that were charging discharge energy based on the current energy usage in an effort to reduce utility bills for these businesses. So think about trying to predict what their energy usage will be 15 minutes ahead, an hour ahead, day ahead. And then also worked for a data analytics startup providing analytics tools for DevOps people. So think about all the data thrown off by your applications and cloud systems, lots of unstructured log data, lots of structured time series metrics, making that all useful and understandable. And a really interesting machine learning for that way to be able to do some anomaly detection on that data. And then again, I already mentioned General Assembly. I'm going to talk a little bit more about the way I got into this and how it relates to what we're going to talk about today. So, starting my career off in product management and big companies, there are all these teams that had very capable data science people on them that I worked with. So, I developed an understanding of how training a machine learning algorithm works and different parts of the process, but didn't really have to get too hands on. As I got into smaller companies and startups, I learned that in order to prototype some of the products I wanted to build, I really need to be able to get more hands-on with the data science myself. Also, as time went on, I grew less content to sort of just have a top-level understanding, and I really wanted to get more hands-on. So I started teaching myself Python, checking out some of the online courses that are available to learn machine learning and data science, and then to really kind of get to the next step, I ended up taking the very first instance of the data science course given at General Assembly here in San Francisco. I got a ton out of that, really enjoyed that, had the opportunity to come back as a TA, did that, and then came back as a lead instructor and now taught the course as a lead instructor four times. A couple things I've learned in the process of doing that that I want to share with this group is, one, you don't need a PhD in physics be a data scientist, or to learn and apply machine learning to algorithms. All you need is some quantitative mindsets, a little bit of quantitative background, and some hacking skills. And the hacking skills you can also develop along the way. So one, it's very approachable, it's very easy to learn, particularly with the number of resources out there today. Two, one of the other things I learned along the way was that a lot of the terminology in machine learning kind of made it difficult to get up and running because the terms aren't necessarily intuitive. A lot of them come from applications of these algorithms 30, 40 years ago. Some of them are just sort of very academic terms that once we understand what they actually mean make more sense. So one of the things I want to do as we go along today is make sure that that terminology is really clear and understandable. And also that we explain the concepts, we can build whole groups of concepts in a really intuitive way. I found as I was learning that having an application related to and approaching things more intuitively was really a good way to make it understandable. Alright. So why machine learning? I've seen all here this Sunday morning, so you're intrigued by it, you want to learn a little bit more. One big reason is that applications of machine learning are everywhere. Some of them are really obvious, some of them are so integrated into the products we use in our day-to-day lives, we probably don't even notice them. Also, of course, there are some hugely successful enterprises that have been built around applying machine learning and various machine learning techniques. So you can see a big list of them here. I'm not going to read through all of those. I'll give you a second to read through those. And then we actually got our first exercise of the morning, which is an easy one, just to kind of make sure we're awake. So what I'd love everybody to do is, if you just get in groups of maybe like 3 to 5, if you're at a big table, maybe just turn one way or the other and kind of group into two groups. Read through these and together go through and see if you can name companies that have taken this application of machine learning and turn it into a business. Some of them will be really obvious. And also in the process, if you can think of other applications of machine learning or other companies using machine learning that aren't listed up here, write those down as well. Just take like 3 or 4 minutes to do that, and I'll ask everybody to volunteer one match for the application listed up here. So one company for the application listed up here. Cool. So let's do that right now.
I don't know what's going on.
Zach, new products to Amazon, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, awesome. And then any you think of that aren't already on the list?
I don't know, like everywhere.
Exactly. And then there's one more luxury area. Oh, cool.
Facebook relation in the internet of phone. So the applications when you upload a picture and it starts recognizing what answer for.
Yep, face recognition definitely. Cool, and then maybe one more person over there.
Predicting functions of proteins at every pharmaceutical company, and we have the supplies that are AstraZeneca on the line. But then the kind of the one that's not out there is the end result prediction of outcome, health outcomes, and that's something that has a kind
of like people that. Yep, great one, thank you. Cool, awesome. Well, thanks for participating in that. Again, the point here that I want to get across is machine learning is everywhere, the applications are only growing. And with it, of course, demand for data scientists and machine learning engineers, machine learning practitioners. Last time I did a search on Indeed, just for machine learning, I believe the average salary that came back is around $150,000 to $156,000. You know, data scientists is a little above that because there's some noise in the results. Widely applicable, lots of demand, which of course is a great reason to learn more about it, as well as of course your own curiosity. We named a lot of the companies listed up here. One that we didn't talk about already was 538, which is Nate Silver's blog. He's really famous for calling the presidential election back several years ago now. So that's another application of machine learning, is to calling political races, as one example. Okay, so a little bit more machine learning context. So, you know, we use the terms data science, we use the terms machine learning. You know, how are they similar, how are they different? There was a great blog post made by Drew Conway a couple of years ago. The URL for it's on the slide. Post is about the data science Venn diagram. And you really describe data science as the overlap between three fields, which were math and statistics, hacking skills, or your programming, and substantive expertise. I kind of prefer the term domain knowledge, but the idea here is you know something about the field to which you're applying the statistics and the programming. And you can see the intersection of these different circles in the Venn diagram. Drew was kind of labeled different areas. So the intersection of hacking skills and math and statistics knowledge is where what he called machine learning, and I would agree with that. Okay. Another great quote is that it was actually about data scientists, but you substitute machine learning practitioners just as well. It was that data scientists are better programmers than most statisticians, and better statisticians than most programmers. And that's really what we're going to concentrate today, is on the intersection of those two. At the intersection of all three is what we call data science. It's really applying these tools in a way where you know something about the field. The intersection of math and statistics knowledge with substantive expertise is more what you think about in a typical university program that doesn't have a computational component. So this is more traditional research, for example, without the hacking skills. And then the last section there that's labeled danger zone, that has the hacking skills and domain expertise but not the math and statistics. What we're trying to get across there is that if you don't understand enough of the math and statistics, there are open source libraries out there that are super useful where you can start to apply machine learning algorithms pretty easily with some Python code. So if you know how to code, you can figure out the documentation, you can start applying these algorithms. The danger is that certain of these algorithms have certain assumptions about what type of problem you're trying to solve, what your data looks like, some statistical assumptions in some cases. And we'll talk more about that today. But the idea, I think, with this section that's labeled danger zone is not to just apply models as kind of a black box. You really need to understand when they're appropriate, what they're trying to do. So a little bit of distinction there between data science and machine learning, but obviously they're closely related. Another way to think about machine learning is that it's really one part or one or two parts of the overall data science workflow. Everybody has their own definition of the data science workflow. So Hillary Mason, who is the chief scientist at Bitly and is now at Excel Venture Partners, has a five-step process. She talks about obtaining data, scrubbing data, scoring data, modeling, and then interpreting your results. So, I'm not going to go through the whole data science workflow, but I love her quote here, which I haven't really attributed to her, but the quote about modeling. All models are wrong, but some are useful. And as we get more into understanding how good our models are and how to validate them, that will start to make more sense. Like, machine learning models are almost never going to be 100% accurate. Almost none are. It really depends on what you're trying to do and what accuracy level is acceptable to you. So there are commercial applications where you have 85% accuracy level, maybe 20 for what you're trying to do. Jeff Hammerbacher, who was at both Facebook and Cloudera, and is now, I believe, at Mount Sinai Hospital, actually, has more steps to his workflow. You'll see that there's similarities in all of these. Here, number five is build model, and number six is evaluate model. So those are the pieces that we're going to be talking about more today in terms of machine learning. So if you think, if you hear the terms data science, excuse me, data science and machine learning, they're tightly interrelated. I think machine learning is really applying to that model building, model evaluation part of the data science workflow. Okay, so let's talk about a little bit of machine learning workflow. So in that context of building and evaluating models, what are we doing? How does this work? So a couple of bits of terminology. So you'll hear training a model and, of course, testing a model. The term training a model really means that we're going to take some existing data set, some data that we've gathered in the past, and we're going to feed that into our algorithm to try to either fit a curve or form some sort of baseline model that we can then use on data we haven't seen yet to make predictions. So this is where the machine learning algorithms get into more of the predictive analytics. So we're not trying to understand the precise shape of a distribution, for example. What we're trying to do is create an algorithm based on data we have that's useful in predicting something about data we haven't seen yet. In the process of doing that, once we build a model, we need to understand how well did it do. So that's the model evaluation. We'll talk about some techniques for doing that today. By far, the most important one is called cross-validation. We'll talk more about that. It's another term that sounds complicated, but once you understand what's going on, it's actually not. And then model optimization. So a lot of the models will have different knobs that you can turn, different dials, different settings. Some of them are very simple and have maybe one knob you can turn. Some have more knobs that are more complicated. Those knobs you can turn are called hyperparameters. In another complicated sounding word, it really just means a knob you can turn. And generally, there's going to be an optimal setting for that particular knob for the model you want to build. We'll look at a simple example of that much later on. Often you'll go through a couple of iterations of model building, model testing, model optimization. You might try different algorithms. So if we're given classes of problems involving more than one algorithm that applies, once you come up with a model that it performs well enough for what you're trying to do, then comes the fun part. Then we get to throw new data at it and make predictions. So that's really the bottom part of this diagram. Which is basically saying, okay, once we've got a model, let's feed new data in that we haven't seen before, get predictions out. Okay. So that was a little bit of context. I want to talk about why machine learning, why is it exciting, why is it important? How does it fit in with the concept of data science? Obviously, it's slightly interrelated, but they're really talking more about the model building process. process. Now, let's dig into machine learning. So, we'll cover what is machine learning, some machine learning solutions. We'll talk about classification problems in particular as one example of machine learning. We'll talk about how to build and evaluate classifiers. We'll talk about cross-validation as one specific tool for doing that. And I'll talk a little bit about one algorithm, which is called k-nearest neighbors, which is a really simple classification technique. If we get through all that, then we can also talk a little bit about regression models. Well, let's see how far we get. So that's our roadmap. All right, any questions on what we've covered so far? Yeah?
Can you clarify the difference between machine learning and data science? I know it's a subset of data science, it's a general field.
Sure.
Are there any other subfields within data science that's not machine learning?
So in the overall data science workflow, and let me go back to that. Let me go back to that slide to just answer more generally. So there's a lot of things in data science that aren't specifically machine learning. So just obtaining data, where do you get that data? Often, you aren't just handed a nicely packaged data set. You may need to write a bunch of SQL queries to pull that from your company's database. You may need to do a bunch of web scraping. You may need to hit a web API, pull back some JSON data. Often the features that you want, so the features, another term, are the inputs to the machine learning model. Those probably aren't going to all exist in one place. So what you'll need to do is pull information from disparate sources, get it in a format that you can use as the input to the machine learning model. Then there's the whole issue of data scrubbing. So there was a great article in the New York Times with Monica Rogatti, who's the head data science lead at Jawbone, at least it was at the time, and she was talking about data janitorial work. And the quote you'll hear repeated a lot is that 80% of the time spent data munching or cleaning data, and only 20% of the time is actually spent building predictive models. So there's all sorts of things you'll run into there, just to name a few, right? There's character encoding issues, there's missing data issues, there's data formatting issues, date times can come in all sorts of different formats, converting those into one consistent representation, can take a lot of time. There's also just understanding the data that you have. An important way to do that is data visualization. So data visualization certainly is used as part of machine learning, but it's much more broadly applicable. So understanding how to actually get in the visual picture of your data, using libraries, and there's lots of open source libraries, for this, Matplotlib is one that's been around for a long time. There's one called Seaborn. There's a newer one called Bokeh, which provides a wrapper around D3E, so it provides some really awesome visualizations. But the whole field of data visualization is part of data science, but not necessarily part of machine learning. Then after you've built the model and you're getting useful results out of it, you still need to communicate what you've done. And this is often to a non-technical audience. So another part of data science that's not strictly part of machine learning is data communication, data storytelling, helping people who aren't data scientists understand the value of what you've done and what it means for the business. So those are all things that are part of data science but not strictly part of machine learning. And that's it. Also just from a goal for today's standpoint, what I really want to cover and leave you with is kind of a baseline understanding of machine learning, how to build and evaluate machine learning models, and all the terminology involved, so that this afternoon's presentation on getting hands-on with scikit-learn, which is one of the primary open source libraries for applying machine learning algorithms in Python, so if that makes sense, then obviously that baseline knowledge, a lot of the material at the conference on November 14th and 15th will make sense as well. Okay, cool. Any other questions before we go on? Great. Okay. So what is machine learning? Where did it come from? Kind of an interesting story. So in 1958, a computer scientist named Arthur Samuel computer program to play checkers. Not chess, checkers. And he originally tried to attack the problem by assigning scores to various positions on the checkerboard. As you can imagine, these scores were based on things like how many pieces the other player had left, the various positions on the board, and you know that worked, but the performance wasn't that great. It was fairly complicated. So we started off, you know, amateur checker players could easily use this program. But 10 years later, he had actually found a way that it was playing at least at the amateur level, and at one point defeated, I think it was the fourth-ranked checkers player. So, how did he do that? He had an idea for improving performance that was better than this method of assigning scores of positions based on various rules he came up with. Can you think, just take a second to think about, like, how might he have actually improved the performance? Anybody want to play? Yeah?
You predict what the other side would do.
Ooh, so sort of a game theory approach. I like that. I like that. And in a way, that's kind of what he did. So his big idea was to have the program play thousands of games against itself and use the experience it gained in those playing thousands of games against itself to improve the positional score. So it kind of saw both sides of the game. And through that experience of thousands of games, and feeding that back into the scores, he actually created a program that was able to improve its performance through experience. You can think about the outcome of those games and intermediate steps as the data that fed back into the model. And that was really kind of the origin of machine learning, this program that could learn from itself. He also gave a definition of machine learning. Obviously, you can read the slide. It said, machine learning is a field of study that gives computers the ability to learn without being explicitly programmed. It's kind of beautiful in its generality. Let's talk a little bit about that part without being explicitly programmed. So think about trying to create a program to identify credit card fraud, or predict how long it's going to take a car or a taxi to get to a particular destination. And one way you can approach that is trying to identify all of the variables that affect that and try to build in different rules. Right? You might say, for example, with the credit card fraud problem, okay, well, if the transaction is coming from these countries or these IP addresses, then make it increase its likelihood of being fraud by 30%. The problem is that that sort of rule-based approach grows very complexity very, very quickly. It's hard to maintain. So the neat thing about machine learning is through the application of statistics to a lot of data, we're able to create models that don't require being explicitly programmed. They don't require you to identify and take care of every case. But they can learn from experience or from data. That's a photo of Arthur Samuel from the Stanford website. Toward the end of his career, he was a professor at Stanford. And you can see him there with an old school, like it's a teletype, and his checkers board. Okay. Another definition, a little bit more specific. So this is the definition of a well-posed machine learning problem. This comes from Tom Mitchell at Carnegie Mellon University. This one's a little bit more academic. But I also like it because it gives some insight. So, obviously you can read that, but the idea is that a computer is said to learn from experience with respect to some task and some performance measure. If it gets better at that task, as measured by that performance measure, over time. So you think of experience as more time, more data, really. And that was from a book he wrote in 1997. An analogy for that, if you want to think about how to translate to something a little bit more concrete, you can think about a student learning from a college course. So if the performance measure is midterms and finals, and the experience is readings and homework, then if that student gets better over time,
as measured by that performance measure, then that's also an example of learning. Don't know if that analogy is that helpful, but those are two definitions. Wikipedia definition is presented here. Two important things that Wikipedia mentions are representation and generalization. We'll talk a little bit about both today, and we'll dive more into generalization. These are two more terms you'll encounter a lot in machine learning. It's important to understand conceptually what they mean. So when we talk about representation, we're talking about extracting structure from the data. We don't necessarily have labels for different categories. We don't necessarily have existing house prices. We've got some sort of data, and we want to understand what features in that data might be important. What contributes to the most variance? Are there inherent clusters in the data? Okay. That's representation of the notion of extracting structure. Generalization, which is more common, is that notion of being able to make predictions from the data. So we want to think back to that data science workflow slide. We want to take our existing data, build a model, and use that model to generalize to data we haven't seen yet. So these are two terms that will pop up again and again. And then, just to finish off kind of the definition of what is machine learning, it's also obviously in computer science that develops these algorithms. So if you get in, if you were actually in a PhD program, academics will get into designing new machine learning algorithms, mathematically proving that those machine learning algorithms work and perform. And then also machine learning is related to statistical learning theory and pattern recognition. Okay. So when do we need machine learning? This is just one example that kind of goes back to and reinforces that point about not being explicitly programmed. So we need it if there are some observable patterns that exist, and we have data on those. There's probably no explicit or closed form equations. So an example here that's kind of more of a simple physics example is a pendulum that has another pendulum attached to it. And if you start this swinging and measure the positions of both the middle and the end of the pendulum, it won't make nice little sinusoidal waves. It'll make very choppy sort of motions. And there's not really a closed-form solution to this. But with enough data, measurements of how that pendulum with another pendulum on it moves, you can actually feed that into a machine learning algorithm and predict the position at different points in time. Kind of an abstract example, but a good one in that there's an observable pattern. We can collect data, but there's not necessarily a formula that we can use. And therefore, we can't explicitly program it. Okay. So that's a little bit of what is machine learning. Now let's talk about some machine learning solutions, some of which we touched on at first. Before we go into that, any questions on the what is machine learning portion? Nope.
Machine learning is like very much problem agnostic. You can go some way of thinking, it's agnostic whether you want to reach
the goal. Sure, I'll repeat that since it's in the mic. So the question is kind of two. One, is it product agnostic? And two, can you implement any language? And so I'll start with the second one first. Yeah, you can write machine learning algorithms in many different languages, and there are machine learning libraries available in different languages. Python is a great one. R is another more of a statistical language that has lots of great libraries for building statistical models and doing statistical machine learning. There are also machine learning libraries for a lot of more big data systems. So Spark is one that's increasing in popularity and kind of starting to replace Hadoop, which is an in-memory system for crunching big data. It has a library called MLVib. It implements a lot of machine learning libraries. Spark and his library is written in Scala, but also has some Python APIs. So yeah, you could also, if you were writing your own, you could write it in C or C++, Java.
begin performance, another challenge. But, so yeah, it doesn't, it's, it can be written in any language, in many languages anyway. And then product agnostic, we'll talk a bit more about that. It's really about identifying the typical problem you're trying to solve, and what data you have, and then mapping that to the machine learning algorithm or classical algorithms that will apply for that classic problem. So it's actually a great segue. So we already talked about generalization as taking existing data and making predictions. So if you think about learning in general, it's not about memorizing, being able to recall what you memorized, particularly with Google and search engines today. But it's more about taking what you've learned already, what you've already seen, and generalizing that to things that you haven't seen. One way of thinking about types of machine learning solutions, this kind of gets to the question you asked, is what's the type of question that you want to answer? So one type of machine learning algorithm, this is another term, it sounds complicated, but it isn't, and you'll hear again and again, is supervised learning. At its most basic, supervised learning means that the data that we have to build the model also has the answers. Those answers are what we're trying to predict from new data. So if it's house prices, for example, it means that we've got a bunch of inputs like the square footage of the house, its location, how old it is, number of bedrooms, and we also have the actual price of that house, you know, maybe the last time it transacted. If it's more of a classification algorithm, I'll say that we're trying to, again, I'll use the example of credit card fraud. If we're trying to decide if a particular transaction is going to be fraudulent or not, then the data that we use to build that algorithm needs to be labeled with this transaction was fraudulent, this transaction was not fraudulent. Or if we're making a lending decision, this loan was repaid, this loan was not repaid. So those are what's called the labels, and they can either be class labels like repaid, not repaid, fraudulent, not fraudulent, or they can be real numbers like house prices. The reason it's called supervised learning originally was going back to this notion of machine learning, the computer program that can learn from experience. Well, in supervised problems, the idea is that, well, it needs a human to supervise it. It can't just look at the data and extract a prediction, which you can do when you're just trying to get the structure out of the data. So supervised learning means that you're mapping from some sort of inputs to some sort of outputs, and most importantly, that the data you're using to build the model has those labels, it has those answers for that data. Okay, so let's talk about a couple of examples. So one example of machine learning is optical character recognition. And it's a classic problem of trying to identify handwritten numbers, handwritten digits. This was originally done actually for the Postal Service, and the data set that's available online, I believe, is actually for the French Postal Service. And you can think about all the different ways that people write numbers, right? Some are really legible, some are hard to read. Sometimes people, you know, put a little top on the one, sometimes a little straight through the seven. But we want to be able to identify the zip code from these handwritten numbers. So, this is actually a classification problem where we're trying to take an image and classify it as a class 0 through 9 representing that number. So, question I want to pose to the group, particularly for anybody that's, you know, coming from more of a software engineering type of background. Can you think of ways, or let me rephrase it, how might we take images and turn them into inputs so we could actually feed into an algorithm? Think about that for a second.
Put it to like a hash table, you sort of hash like you've seen before, or you put it with a tree structure, and sort of, you know, where you can sort of make decision trees and decide which way to go based off of the input.
Nice. You've gone through a lot of technical interviews, haven't you?
Yes.
Hash table, length list, tree structure, what do you want?
Yeah.
Cool. So I like the direction you're going. Anybody else want to take a step? He said I offered two things. He said one is you can put it with some sort of a tree structure, or you can create a hash table, So a hash table, those who aren't familiar, basically creates a long unique number that you can use to determine if you've seen something before. It's often used for managing memory with data systems. Not that complicated in this case. Basically, when it was going to turn an image into some numbers you can use an algorithm. So what they actually did in this case was they took each image, made it approximately the same size, and then overlaid an 8x8 grid. So each image was 64 pixels. And each pixel had a grayscale value. Kind of think about from 0 to 1, right, from black to white. And so each image then had 64 features or inputs that were the grayscale value of each pixel in that image. That was the input to the machine learning problem. And so they were able to actually get this to perform quite well to the point that it was actually used to recognize zip codes on letters going through the Wilson system. So one example, and this is a supervised classification problem. Classification, because we want to take the image and say it's 0 through 9, each one of those is its own group or class. And supervised, because when we were training it, when we were building the model, we actually knew what the digit was for each one of these images, as you can see on the slide. Cool, so let's talk about another one. Credit scoring. Capital One bookable business on being able to provide credit decisions to people quickly and easily online. This is also something that's used in micro-lending in emerging countries. And banks, of course, will often have machine learning models to determine whether or not to make a level loan. So in this case, each example or record, so this is another term that you'll hear used a lot, a record or example just means one instance of the data set that you have. So in this case, it's a person applying for a loan. In the biggest case, it was a handwritten digit. And then for each person, each example, we've got here 7 features that we can feed into the model. And these are the age, gender, salary, years in job, how much debt they currently have, whether or not they paid off their credit in the past. You can think of this as being something that either the bank has in their relationship, or you can pull from a credit rating agency like Experian with a credit score. So 3 examples, 8 features, and then the paid off credit, I think, is actually the label in this case. So basically, were they creditworthy in previous lending situations? This is another example of a supervised model. It can either yield a decision like yes, no, lend, or it can give you a score that you can use and say, okay, I'm only going to lend people who have above a certain score. And so if you think about that notion of building a model and generalizing from that model, the data on the left is an example, it's a subset of the data used to train the model. And the data on the right is that new example, it's that new person coming in where we want to figure out should we or should we not lend to this person. So spam detection is another well-known application of machine learning. Basically, people are looking at an email message and automatically determine whether it's spam or not spam. In the literature, often the not spam is called PAM. So if you see that terminology, PAM just means not spam. So let's take a minute and think about some of the features that we might feed into our machine learning model that you think might have predictive power. And so if the credit score, we saw what they were. For the spam detection, think about features of an email message and what we might use to feed into a model. Think about that for a second and ask people to provide some. The suggestion was the date of the email. Because a lot of times spammers will send it to something in the future, so it shows up at the top of your queue. Obviously, if it's sent in the future, that didn't actually happen. probably spam. So that's a great feature. Any other features you can think of? Sure.
Domain.
The domain that it came from, so it came from, certainly you have a list of known spammer domains, and you can do a lookup against that. That's a great one. Absolutely. Any others? Yep.
File size.
File size, interesting. Okay, tell me more about that one.
So for a lot of spam emails, they generally can take a large file size, and so that's a huge spam.
Interesting. Yeah, particularly if it's more of a malicious email, I mean, I can see the file size being interesting. And then, do you have another one?
Not sure if this is true or not, but maybe it's the recipient, like no one person, but maybe they send it to ECC a whole bunch of people, and the very overlay content when you see similar across all emails sent out to a whole bunch of people.
Yeah, that's a great one. Got some other ideas. Okay, cool. Let's start off the DAC.
So like it's here's an example. So what Gmail is doing it, so whenever they in the text they have something like SSN or verified information, so now you, they have started classifying that.
Yeah, so that's a great one for identifying phishing attacks. The response goes if some of the text in the email mentions a social security number or a bank account number, then it's probably a phishing attack, right? Or you can use an entering spam email as a good one. Cool. I think
content of the text would be the application of other science.
Awesome. Yeah, so a lot of what we've talked about to this point is metadata, it's header information, which are you know, everything we talked about are great features. There's also the actual text of the email. So that, as it turns out, is very useful in building a machine learning model to determine if email spam or not spam. There's a model called 90 days, and essentially it looks at the words in the email as related to all the words used in kind of all your email. And certain terms are used much more frequently in spam. You can think of things like, you know, Viagra, but also just, you know, very commercial messages. And by comparing the frequency of words in email known to be spam, so again, supervise this label if there's some set of email that you know is spam. Comparing the words used in that and the words used in sort of English language as a whole, you can then build a model that predicts whether or not an email is spam, or gives you a probability. And the great thing about this is that the more examples of spam you have, the better the model gets. And even if spammers change their tactics, if you have access to a lot of spam emails, you can update your model very quickly. So this is one reason that Gmail does such a great job at identifying spam, is because it essentially sees everybody's spam across everybody's email with them. And as soon as the spammer tries something new, that can study into the model. Cool, so that was great. Thanks for contributing those features. Like the way everybody's thinking. Alright, a lot of those were classification examples. Let's talk about one simple not so simple, but or regression example here. So we talked about housing price prediction, and you can also predict stock prices. Predicting stock prices is a little trickier because the price at any point in time depends heavily on the price at time t minus 1. Okay, so this is what's called time series data, where each observation is not independent, but actually heavily dependent on what came before it. Still, you can use machine learning models and regression to try to do stock price prediction of, you know, what's it going to be in the next day, the next hour. I've heard this in trading firms, I heard that term, actually do something like this where they're actually applying relatively simple regression models, but really, really quickly to try to predict whether a stock is going to be up or down in the next 200 milliseconds, and then fire off a bunch of orders based on that. So this is another example of supervised learning, in that to be able to predict that real numbered output, you need to have a data set that has those numbers in your training data.
And there's multiple regression where there's multiple inputs to and multiple features to your model. Again, the house price prediction is a great example of this. So some features you might have are the square footage of the house, number of bedrooms, quality of the school district, age of the house, maybe zip code. And so if you have multiple dimensions upon which value kind of is dependent, then you'll have a multiple regression model. Here's a simple example just with two inputs and one output. So based on the number of years of education, number of years of school, and number of years in the job, it's trying to predict the salary for a particular job. The reason it's only got two inputs is it starts to get really hard to visualize things in both dimensions. But that's another example of supervised learning. Okay. We talked a lot about supervised learning because it's by far the most common application that you'll see in industry. A lot of commercial applications are all about supervised learning. Another term and another type of machine learning solution is unsupervised learning. And unsupervised learning, as you might guess, you don't have those answers in your training data. You actually don't know the house prices, you don't know whether or not somebody paid back their loan. But you're trying to extract, in this case, some structure from the data. So think about clusters, perhaps customer segments, right? If you have a bunch of customer data, you're trying to figure out if you can tease out personas, you might run a clustering algorithm and see what comes out of that. The clustering algorithm will give you the groupings and who's in what grouping. It will be up to you to understand what those groupings mean, right? And then you might assign labels to them. And then you might be able to turn that into a supervised model where for a new customer coming in, you can predict what customer segment they're in. But that's a follow-on step. Another example of unsupervised learning is dimensionality reduction. The idea there is that if you have a data set with, you know, tens or hundreds of features, you often want to figure out which features are the most important. Maybe only 10 of those 200 features give you most of the signal, most of the useful information in your data set. So this is another example of unsupervised learning, where you're just trying to understand the structure inherent in the data. You don't actually have labels that you're trying to predict. And going back to the, you know, does it need humans to supervise it? The idea here is that, well, actually, no, here the computer can just figure out the structure on its own using essentially using math without any label information about human supervising it. So those, here's a clustering example. This is an example of what four really well-defined clusters might look like. In practice, they're really only that far apart. There's often some overlap. So kind of back to that Wikipedia definition of representation and generalization. When we talk about supervised models and making predictions, that's generalization. We've got data, we built a model, we want to make a prediction. We're generalizing the data we haven't seen yet. Unsupervised models are about extracting structure. Are there clusters? Can we figure out which features are the most important? Those two bits of terminology, supervised and unsupervised, are pervasive throughout machine learning. You'll see them again and again. So it's really important to understand what they mean, also intuition about it, which is why I've spent so much time on it. Okay. So, oh yeah, sorry.
So just, can you go back to last time?
Absolutely.
The validating the supervised model is easy because when you continue to hold results, you can see whether or not you call your model predictive. How do you validate it on supervised?
So a couple pieces there. Let me repeat the question and use it in the mic. So the question was essentially, how do you validate an unsupervised model? And then as part of that, we're talking a little bit about how you validate a supervised model. So we're getting into that in more detail. So with a supervised model, there are techniques we can use. Why don't we first build a model to understand how it works performs? And then if you put out more data, you might actually get a better model. With an unsupervised model, again, if you're doing something like clustering, you don't inherently know that the clusters that came out of it have like, commercial use. You don't necessarily know, like I said, for the customer segmentation, you don't actually know that those are your useful customer segments. What you do know is mathematically, those are the data points that are the most similar relative to other data points. And similar with dimensionality reduction, it comes down to the math. You can actually, Situadism looks at the direction of the most variance in your data across multiple dimensions. And if a particular feature, it kind of just looks like a big cloud of points, then it's assumed to be more random noise, versus if it looks like more of a straight line, then that's assumed to be lots of signal. So, I mean, mathematically, you can say, hey, these are the 5 or 10 features that are the most important in terms of the most variance in my model. You need some understanding, again, of the one you're trying to solve, to understand the assumptions behind that math are about. So, that's a great segue to evaluating supervised models. So before we get into evaluating supervised models, we have a second exercise for the day. It's the same thing. I want you guys to work in small groups, and essentially we've got 3 examples. We'll probably be pretty straightforward based on what we've done already, because everyone's asking good questions. We're just going to take like a minute each and talk amongst yourselves, figure out if you think this one is a supervised or unsupervised application of machine learning, and why. It's also important to understand the why. Alright, so first one, how's the prediction? Supervised models to this if you understand which of, say, 50 different features were actually the most useful in making that prediction. But really, this is a supervised problem. All right, next one, and again, we'll spend 60 seconds on this one. Document classification, one we haven't talked about.
I don't see, you know, like, unsupervised. trying to classify things. But then we saw the labels, and we were trying to classify the buckets. So those buckets are provided for the table. So it's supervised.
Perfect. That's exactly right. Yeah. This one's a little bit less obvious, but the fact that we have the labels, right, we're trying to put things in the buckets of this is a check, this is an order, this is a claim, means that we already have those labels, and it's a supervised problem. If we just had a bunch of documents and we had no idea what was in that bunch of documents, then it would be an unsupervised problem because we'd be trying to understand how many different clusters, how many different types of documents there are. But this is not supervised because we have those labels. Okay. Increasing in difficulty? We got one more. I'll give this one like 2 minutes. All right, go.
You have more information, more detailed, like granular information on the students. So quickly supervise. You can use it to predict, it's a question that you're asking. Maybe it's about like how are Carnegie Mellon MBA students searching for jobs. It's relative, or how do they perform after graduation or something. Let's track their 9-month history or something. So it depends on, if that's their searches, you have access to the entire network through the searches that they're doing for their respective accounts. SSO, like when the log is, so it's depending on what perspective you take.
All right, awesome, thank you. Okay, I've got a question.
So, in terms of kind of the difference, so
just because you use it for community detection as in looking for structure, is that that means it's unsupervised as opposed to a classification algorithm to figure out who these people are, which would make it a supervised algorithm because you know where the buttons are going to?
Exactly the right question to ask. So the short answer is everybody nailed it. This is one that could be either. A little bit of a trick question. And the answer is it depends on what data you have. And the logic, the reason you guys gave is it's perfect. It's spot on. So if all you had was a big social graph and you didn't have anybody's information, right? They didn't have their employers on their resume, which of course LinkedIn has, then it would be an unsupervised problem because you're just trying to figure out what are the clusters, how many are there, and how big are they? And then you'd be trying to figure out what those actually mean. But if you already have enough data, and a bunch of people already signed up from LinkedIn, where you can label these clusters, right, then if somebody else joins, you can have a pretty good idea before they even filled out their resume, just based on who they know, where they worked. So that would be more of a supervised problem. So a little bit of a trick question. You guys all nailed it. That was perfect. It really depends on what data you have. So awesome.
Good.
Sunday morning too. Yeah. Okay, let's get to the mic. So, hi, where'd you go?
Is it fair to say that all problems start with answer to what's learning and then sort of based on what you find and what you learn, then you come to the answer to what you try?
So the question was, is it fair to say that all problems start out unsupervised and then become supervised? And the answer is no, it's not fair to say all. It's definitely fair to say some. So there are definitely a number of problems where you will have the label training data you need to build a model. Again, there's probably a lot of data munging work you're going to need to do to get that right format. But you will know what question you want to ask when you'll have the data to build the model. There are definitely also questions where you will have to start off unsupervised and then use what you learned to feed into a supervised model. Digging even a little bit more deeply into that, I mean, no reason clustering is an example because it's a really intuitive example, but dimensionality reduction, a lot of times if you want to make your model run more quickly, then you will want to take something that you may have, you know, again, 100 features and you don't know which features are useful, apply dimensionality reduction to it, pick out the 5 or 10 that are the most useful, and then feed those into your supervised model. So to your point, it's definitely common that you will chain unsupervised and supervised together, but it's not fair to say all. Cool, great question, thank you. Any other questions? Alright, cool. Okay, let's get through the second part of types of machine learning solutions, and then we'll take a break. We're coming up on 11. So we talked about the type of question you want to ask, the type of problem you want to solve. There's another important question, which is what's the type of data that you have or more importantly that you want to get out of your model? So this might be obvious based on the conversation so far. So there's continuous data and categorical data. And again, this is really specific to the data you want to get out of your model. Continuous, real number, house price, probability of having cancer, credit score, probability of repaying a loan, number of minutes before you Uber gets to your house, right? All of a sudden, confidence interval. Categorical is going to be a class, a group, a category. So, you know, digits 0 through 9, even though those are numbers, are actually classes. If somebody does or does not have cancer, or there's another example of categorical is there's a classic data set of passengers on the Titanic, 892 passengers on the Titanic. This is a well-known cattle competition if anybody's played around with this, and if not, I highly recommend it as a way to learn. Did they survive or not survive? So those are the two categories. Is this credit card transaction fraud or not fraud? And the nuance here is that there are some problems where you can actually get out the probability of being in a class. So there, it's you can actually get a continuous or a categorical number out, and then which category the result is actually, it depends on where you draw the line on that probability. So continuous and categorical are the two types of data. Here are some more examples just to reinforce that, right? So again, continuous, think real numbers. You know, heights of people, weights of cars, speeds of vehicles, stock prices, categorical and categories. Eye colors, highest degree earned, gender, you know, workshops at ODSC, and whether or not email is spam. You put that all together, and you get a really nice overview of nearly all machine learning algorithms. Like all models are not, this framework is a great way to think about machine learning algorithms and what you want to apply, how to map the algorithm to the problem you're trying to solve. The 2x2 isn't perfect, it's not going to cover 100% of everything, but it's a really useful framework. So, you think about supervised models, so we've got the labels, we've got the answers we're looking for. If we want a continuous output, those are regression models. Linear regression, multiple regression, time series models. If we have the labels and we want to get a class or a category out of it, then that's a classification problem. Literally, which class is this example in? In the unsupervised category, if we're dealing more with numbers, dimensionality reduction is a great example of that, and if we're trying to determine what those classes or categories might be, those are clustering algorithms. There are a couple of well-known clustering algorithms as well. So, again, while not perfect, this is a great framework for thinking about the type of problem you have. And if you know what algorithms fall into which bucket of the 2x2 matrix, that will help you map to, oh, I should try this algorithm and this set of algorithms first. Sorry, yeah, that's a misleading slide. These are actually, it's actually one thing. Dimensionality reduction is what it's called. So, for those people who have more of a math background, it's essentially matrix factorization models, or essentially looking for the eigenvectors and eigenvalues of the principal components. So, PCA is another term for the same thing, principal components analysis. We also hear it called SVD, or singular value decomposition, very related. As an editorial aside, while this is a super useful framework, if you want to get very, very academic and literal, you could actually argue that there's just a bunch of different types of unsupervised model, and the distinction between continuous and categorical unsupervised is really broad. But I think it's a useful framework for thinking about what type of problem you have, what you're trying to answer, what data you have, and then mapping to the different types of machine learning algorithms that are available. So any other questions before we take a break? Cool, awesome. So let's take like a 15-minute break, and we'll come back and dive into classification problems. Let's get started back up. We're going to go until 5, which is going to be about 4:30. I think that'll give us enough time to get through the rest of this. And also, one more people ask me about posting on YouTube or maybe posting to GitHub or public GitHub. My email address is on the last slide. Be sure to go off the last slide or come ask me for it. I'm also happy to send you additional references for ways to continue learning about machine learning after this workshop. So if you're interested in that, definitely grab my email address and send me an email. I just mentioned ODSC and any reference on this for. Cool. All right, let's talk about classification problems. Quick review from all of 20 minutes ago. So where in our 2x2 matrix, the supervised, unsupervised, continuous, categorical, where do classification problems fall? Very categorical? That's right. So I heard a bunch of different things. The answer is categorical supervised for classifications. The idea is we've got a bunch of data where we have examples where we know what category or classes examples are in. We use that data to build a model, And then when new data comes in that we haven't already seen, we can feed that through the model to predict which category or class the new data examples are in. Hence classification. We want to basically put it in a bucket, classify it. Okay. There's a famous data set called the IRIS data set, which is available online in the University of California Irvine Data Set Repository. Also, if you're going to stick around this afternoon for Lucas's introduction to scientific learning, which I highly, highly recommend, because it'll be, I believe it'll be a little bit more hands-on with using scikit-learn, which is an open source library for implementing a lot of the machine learning algorithms we're talking about this morning. Scikit-learn also has this data set built in. And so it's a data set of 150 irises, flowers. And in fact, if you go to Wikipedia and search on iris data set, it will actually give you on the page pictures of what these irises look like, so you can visualize it, and it has the whole 150-row data set right there on the Wikipedia page. So the features are measurements of petal length and petal length, petal length and petal width, and kind of a sepal or supple, supple length and supple width. Any botanists in the room know what a supple is? I don't look this up. A sepal?
I'm not a botanist, but it's the leaves under the petals.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. It's the green leaves under the petals that protect the ball when it's closed up and support the leaves of the flower when it's open. So basically, the length and width of the green part and the length and width of the flower part. And he took these 150 measurements for 50 each of three different species of iris flower. And the Wikipedia page says to minimize any noise of the data, he did them all himself on the same day, all in the same location in Canada, for at least two of the three species. And so this is an example of a supervised learning problem, because each one of those 150 examples in our training data is labeled with the species of iris. There's three. There's Setosa, Virginica, and then Versicolor is the third one. And so this is a great data set to use as kind of a toy example for learning about how classification algorithms work. The idea is that we want to then, when we have a new iris flower we want to determine species of, all we need to do is measure the petal length and petal width and the supple length and supple width. And then we can feed that into our machine learning model and get out a predicted class for which species it's in. So a little bit of terminology. So we're all through the concept of independent variables. So these four features, the measurements of the flower, the independent variables. And the dependent variables are the species, which are the class labels. So again, just going back to kind of the terms you will hear most commonly in machine learning and data science, each row in this data set is a record or an example. Each of the first four columns is a feature, and that last column are the class labels. So when you're actually implementing this in code, you're going to have a matrix, which is 150 rows by four columns, which are all your features for all your examples, and then you're going to have a vector of 150 class labels. So you can think of that as your X matrix and your Y vector. We already talked about what supervised means. It means you know the labels. Those species are the class labels for this question, and they're qualitative, right? There's three of them. We talked about how classification problems work, right? You said you provide new data you haven't seen yet in, and you get predictive labels out. So we're essentially mapping the input variables to that predictive class label. Not the more interesting part. Let's talk about how you would actually go through building up and most importantly, validating or testing one of these classification models. So the first thing we do is we actually split the data set. We'll talk about why we do that in more detail in the coming slides. For now, let's just assume that we're going to split it 8 and 20. So that would be 120 rows in one and 30 rows in another. Then we're going to use that 80% of the data to train our model. What that means is we're going to take that data that's labeled, we're going to feed it into whatever algorithm we've chosen, and we're then going to build a model, which is going to be represented by the data or some set of parameters or both. then we're going to test the model. So this is what I think about it. So we're going to take that other 20% of data that we cannot use to train the model. We're going to feed that through the model that we built, minus the class labels. So although we know the right answers, we're not going to feed those right answers through our model or the test data. Then we're going to get out predictions. So this is when we're testing our model, right, we're going to get out predicted class labels for that 20% of data we held back. And we can actually compare those predictions with what we know to be the answers where we had those class labels initially. Another machine learning term that's often called the ground truth. So we can compare the predictions with the ground truth, and we can see how accurate the model we built is. It's not going to be perfect. Can you think of some reasons why it might not be perfect from kind of a statistical perspective? Say again? Yeah, sample size. So generally, the more data you have, the better your model will be, is a general principle. What about small sample sizes makes them error prone? Outliers, yeah, exactly. So outliers, noise, randomness in how the measurements were taken. If you think back to the way this IRC was collected, right? If it was collected by two different people, then there would be some noise or maybe some bias introduced into the measurements themselves. If they were taken from one flower early in the growing season and one flower later in the growing season, that would affect it. So, all things you think about in terms of the data coming in. When you're splitting the data, you also want to actually look at your data. So for the IRIS data set, if you just lopped off the last 30, you would actually get really bad results because the IRIS data happens to be ordered 50, 50, 50. So if you just lopped off the last 30, you would actually get all of, I think, versicolor. You'd get all of one species in your test data. So what you actually want to do is make sure that when you're splitting the data, you actually use some sort of random selection, which scikit-learn gives you. You use some sort of random selection to make sure that the distribution of classes in your training data and your test data is approximately the same. Okay, so to review, we took our data set, we split it 80-20, we trained the model using the 80%, then we took the 20% we held back, took off the labels, fed that data through, got predictions, compared it with the labels that we know to be correct, and that gives us an estimate of how good the model is that we've built. We'll talk more about that later. Then, we can see new data we haven't seen before. Another bit of terminology, this is often called out-of-sample data, which means data we haven't seen yet. We can take that out-of-sample data, feed it through the model we built, and get predictions. Those are the predictions we want. That's why we built the model. We don't actually know how good those predictions are because we don't necessarily know the labels or the ground truth for that new data. That's why having that test set is so important, because having a test set where we know the answers allows us to get an estimate of how accurate our model is going to be on the out-of-sample data, or statistically an estimate of the variance of our predictions on out-of-sample data. We already talked about that. So that was a lot. So before we talk about evaluating how good those were, any questions about the basic model building processes that you're separate? Nope? Okay. Oh, yeah.
Is 80-20 the standard split? Why not 90-10?
So the 80-20 is definitely a heuristic. So the question was, why the 80-20? Why not 90-10? The answer is 80-20 is kind of a heuristic. You can do 70-30, you can do 90-10, as long as you have a big enough data set. And if you only have 100 examples, and then doing 90-10, you only have 10 in your test set, then you're subject to a lot of errors based on that one outlier randomly ending up in your test set. There's a way to get around that, which is called cross-validation, and we'll talk about that in 2 minutes. Other questions? Okay, so how do we know we've built an effective classifier? How do we know we're going to get good let's think about the types of errors that we're going to run into. And this is there are a couple of really important concepts coming up, so I'll go through this next part a little bit more slowly. So there's training error, which basically means when we train our model, or essentially fit our model to our training data, we may not actually classify every single example in the training data correctly. That seems weird, right? Like we know the answers, of course we're going to get it correctly. Well, not necessarily. There's a couple slides later on that will make that more explicit. But if you think about just fitting a curve that kind of divides the two classes, just because of noise or randomness or imperfections in our model, you could end up with a couple of examples from one class that actually fall onto the opposite side of that decision boundary, that curve. So even though we know the answers to the training data, we're not going to have necessarily zero training error. And in fact, we probably don't want zero training error. We'll talk about that, but is anybody, again, kind of thinking from a statistical point of view, maybe think about why we might actually not even want zero training error? Great. Do we lose high on the mic again? Okay, sorry. Anyway, I'll just repeat that. So you said, there could be outliers or exceptions. And that's exactly correct. So there's going to be some inherent noise in our training data. And if you try to tweak the model so you get every single example in the training set perfectly correct, you're actually going to be fitting not just the signal in your data, but also the noise in the data. You're going to get the training examples perfect, but you're going to actually have worse performance on your out-of-sample data. In other words, your model's not going to generalize as well. This is a really important concept. Again, we'll cover it in a little bit more detail. It's called overfitting. So you basically fit your model too closely to the training data. Okay, so that's training error. I actually prefer the term test error instead of generalization error. So the test error is when we take that data that we held back and feed that through our model, how accurate were our predictions relative to what we know to be ground truth? That test error is an estimate of how well we're going to do on the out-of-sample data. I actually like the term generalization error better for the out-of-sample data. It's literally how well does my model generalize the data I haven't yet seen. So training error, test error, out-of-sample, or generalization error. Okay. So let's talk a little bit about why we need training and test sets. So we kind of broached the topic a little bit already. A little thought experiment. So instead of splitting the data set 80-20 or 70-30 or whatever, suppose that we actually put our entire data set into training the model. How low might we be able to push the training error? We talked about that, right? We could theoretically actually push it down to zero. We would do that by making the model arbitrarily complex. Now, complex means different things for different types of models. If you think about a linear regression, or I should say a multiple regression model, we can keep adding more and more features until we've perfectly matched all our training data. So like for house prices, I can start adding things like, does it have a swimming pool? Does it have a swing set? What variety of grass is planted in the yard? Maybe I can take not only the square footage, but like the square of the square footage, or like the square footage to the third power. Like I can keep making my model more and more complicated. I might actually get all the training examples perfectly correct. But that model wouldn't generalize as well the data I haven't seen before. And again, that's called overfitting. Alright. Take a breath right there. So this is a really important visual that represents two really important concepts. One we've talked about, which is overfitting. Another concept is underfitting. And then there's an optimal place that we want to find. So it actually becomes an optimization problem. The general idea is that as we make that model more complex, and again, what complexity means is going to vary depending on the type of model. As we make that model more complicated, we're actually going to push the training error lower and lower and lower. At the beginning of that process, we're also going to push the generalization error lower and lower. But there's going to be a point where, as we start to make the model more complicated and fit our training data, we're actually going to make it more worse on the out of sample data. That spot that we want to hit, that sweet spot, is represented by the vertical line in this diagram. And you can see there that the generalization error, that's that how well are we doing on the data we haven't seen yet. The error goes down to a minimum, and then it starts to creep back up, even as the training error continues to decrease. If we're to the left side of that, meaning that we can actually get better out of sample performance by making a lot more complicated, that means that we're underfitting. We can actually fit the data better. If we're on the right side of that vertical line, that's overfitting. That means we're starting to capture the noise in our data as well as the signal. And we're actually making our predictive performance worse. So where we want to hit is that sweet spot, that minimum in the generalization error. Now, this is a whole separate sort of workshop, but the way you figure out if you're there is mathematically. With all the machine learning algorithms, there's going to be a mathematically defined what's called a cost function or a loss function, and it basically will tell you how well you fit. For those of you who have some statistics background, if you think about even simple linear regression, right, there's the least squares error, right, which is the distance from the line that you fit to each data point above and below. So that is the cost function or loss function for linear regression, and you can actually optimize that by taking the derivative, setting the derivative equal to zero, remember calculus. And for more complicated algorithms, they have it's called a convex shape, which just means kind of a bowl shape. There's a optimization process or algorithm called gradient descent, where you can kind of step through that and find the minimum. Again, whole separate workshop. But the idea is that mathematically we can find that minimum point, and that minimum point is where we want to be, because that's going to give us the best predictive performance on data we haven't seen yet. All right, a lot of concepts packed into that. Underfitting, overfitting, kind of the optimal point where we want to be at. Any questions on that stuff?
It looks like there's a lot of room for overfitting.
It seems like a sweet spot is very highly unlikely to hit, almost, you know, from this graph.
It looks like it's very tough to get to that sweet spot.
So this particular diagram is taken from an array of what's called data analysis for open source tools. Not every model you build is going to have that exact shape, but they're generally all going to have a point where, as you make the model more complicated, your out-of-sample performance gets worse, while your training error continues to decrease. So the distribution isn't always like it's shown here, but there is always, generally always that minimum point. Two things, actually. Does anybody have one more question? Hey, hi, if you can grab the mic for the follow-up question. So I'll paraphrase, but the question that was just asked was, how does this apply to unsupervised models? Like, I can totally understand how it applies to supervised. How does this apply to unsupervised? The answer is it doesn't. This is about classification models are supervised. Cool. I think there was another question.
So my question is, like, when we're building these models, like, how do we actually know where we're at? You know, can you build these graphs per se when we have up? And then we kind of just see, okay, like, this, you build multiple models and just graph it up there? Is that?
So earlier we talked about hyperparameters, and there's knobs you can turn for a given model. Different models have different knobs you can turn. Generally, to find that minimum point, you want to find the ideal settings of those knobs. So, jumping ahead a little bit, we're going to talk about a simple classification algorithm called k-nearest neighbors. There's one parameter you can set for that, which is how many of those nearest neighbors you consult when predicting what class a data point's going to be in. And so as you vary that from, you know, one neighbor to as many as in your entire data set, you're essentially going to get a curve that looks like this. So that's where the hyperparameter tuning comes in. Also, I'm not going to flip way back, but the original slide of the machine learning workflow, there was they build the model, evaluate the model, optimize the model. This is where that model optimization comes in. Is you want to find those parameter settings that give you that minimum generalization error. Cool. Other questions? All right, done. Here's some more visuals to help reinforce that concept of overfitting and underfitting and try to make it a little bit more intuitive. So, in these diagrams, the red circles and the green squares represent examples that are in different classes. So these are the things we're trying to classify into different groups. And the lines in these three different examples, straight in one example and curved in the other, that is the total decision boundary. That's essentially our model. That's the model that we have built based on our training data. And what we're saying is, for data points on one side of that, you're in one class, and for data points on the other side of that, you're in another class. And this is the same data in all three of these examples. And this so in this first upper left example, we're trying to fit a straight line. Think about that. Think about this like linear regression to this data. And as you can see, we don't do very well. There's examples of both classes on either side of it. So this is not a very useful classifier. We can then make the model really complicated and use some like polynomial terms, add a bunch more terms, maybe use like cubic splines or something, and you can get this really convoluted, weirdly shaped decision boundary over on the upper right. It looks like we've done much better, right? So we've got all the green, all the training examples, all those examples are training examples. We've got all the green in one class and all the red in another class. Training error is zero. What's the problem? Let's assume that yellow, it's a little hard to see in the back, but let's assume that yellow dot in the center of the question mark is a new data point that we want to classify. So this is our out of sample data. What's the problem with the one on the upper right as a model?
It's a much easier to reject.
Yeah, so in this case, that new data point represented by the yellow dot is going to get classified as red, even though intuitively it's probably green, right? So this is an example of overfitting. We've made the model way too complicated. It perfectly captures our training data, there's zero training error, but we're going to get an incorrect prediction. So this visual at the bottom represents a model that's at that sweet spot. It's neither underfit nor overfit. And so it's curved, it has some curvature, it's nonlinear, but it doesn't have that crazy amoeba-like shape of the top right. Here, we've also classified the red and the green separately, in this case perfectly, which probably wouldn't happen in practice. The important thing is that out of sample data, that yellow dot is going to be classified correctly in this case. So that's what we want. We want that generalization to give us the right classification. So, the purpose of that was just trying to build a little bit more of a visual intuition behind that notion of underfitting and overfitting. So you can think of upper left as being all the way on the left in the previous diagram, underfitting. Upper right as being further to the right, overfitting. And then one at the bottom as being kind of like right on that line, right, that optimal point. Here's another example. Again, the red and the blue represent examples of different classes that we're trying to classify. And the two lines are different decision boundaries based on different models. The black line represents the optimal model. It's a nice smooth curve. And the green line represents a model that's too complex, that's overfit. This represents a good example of why you don't necessarily want zero training error. So if you think about that decision boundary represented by the black line, you can see that some of the blue are on the wrong side of it, and some of the red are on the wrong side of it. That's the source of our training error. Why those happen could be random noise, it could be their models are perfect, it could be an outlier, it could be something that was just a typo in the data. But the point is, we're not going to get zero training error, because there are some of our training examples that are going to fall on the wrong side of that line. The green line represents zero training error in a really complicated model, but then you can see how, when a new data point comes in, let's say, for example, that a new data point comes in right here. We would expect it to be in the blue class, whatever class that is, but it's going to get classified as red because we've made our model too complicated. Same concept. This one just really shows the notion of how you get non-zero training error. Okay.
Yeah. So in kind of hedging against overfitting,
let me repeat that question. So the question was, is it domain knowledge that informs kind of what side you want to be on? And you brought up type 1 and type 2 error. So this, again, for the statistics people, that'll make sense. For the non-statistics people, it's sort of like true positives and false positives, true negatives and false negatives. So there's a couple answers to the question, and that's actually a really deep question to ask. The short answer to how you know where that minimum point is actually the math. The math behind the algorithms helps you find that minimum point based on that knob you can turn. The type 1 and type 2 errors, you will still have, almost regardless of where you set that knob. Often there's another setting that you can vary. So if you think about modeling gives you a probability of class membership, the probability of transactions fraud, versus just giving you an answer fraudulent or not. Then the question is, where do I draw my line? Do I say that 70% probability is where I draw my line? Or do I say that 85% probability is where I draw my line? That's where the domain knowledge comes in. Who am I going to piss off? And how valuable are they as customers? And what happens? And, you can also do something in practice where you would say, above this line or below this line is human review, and we'll just delay it. Above this line, we'll automatically deny it. Below this line, we'll automatically go through. Based on where you have that, you will actually get those true positives and false positives and true negatives and false negatives. And you can actually build what's called an ROC curve that goes a little bit beyond what I plan to cover today. But it basically gives you a visual picture of how your different types of error vary depending on where you set that threshold of class membership. Another example of this is important is medical testing. Right? So, what's the cost of telling somebody that they have cancer when they don't, versus, and this is usually a trade-off, versus missing someone who does have cancer, telling them that they're testing by negative when they actually do have cancer. And this is where the domain knowledge comes in. If I tell somebody that they have cancer when they don't, and they can go to chemotherapy, well, that would seem pretty awful. Okay? If I tell somebody that, if I miss somebody having cancer, obviously you don't want to agree with the health standpoint, right? But it's that domain knowledge that tells you where you want to set that threshold. So one more example on the opposite of the spectrum, customer churn prediction. Is this customer likely to churn? Churn meaning like that no longer be a customer on like a SaaS or a subscription business. Well, I can get a probability out of my model of how likely they are to churn in the next month. If my action based on the output of that model is simply that I send them a coupon for 15% off the next order, then I'm much more likely to say, if it's above 7%, they'll definitely email me the coupon, right? But if it's only a 70% chance to get the answer, we're not going to say they're going to get the coupon. Right? So that's where the domain knowledge comes in. If you want to look up more about the different types of errors and the ROC curve on Wikipedia, it's ROC curve, or it's also called the receiver operator receiver operating characteristic. Another one of those weird machine learning terms that comes from the days of radio and trying to tune in a signal. So, maybe a bit of a more complete answer than you wanted. Other questions? Alright, cool. Yeah, let's get the mic.
Supervised learning and division models, so to say, and one of the activities is information criteria. We have standard information criteria measured incrementally from reduction of uncertainty, and we have, X amount of parameters to your asking model. Again, my question was back to the one that I asked you, how do I apply something like that to unsupervised learning and classification problems?
Okay. Not sure I totally parsed your question, but I'm going to take a stab at answering it. So, how does this apply to unsupervised learning? It doesn't. This only applies to supervised learning. And in fact, the ROC curves and one of the arrows only apply to binary classification problems. So, A or B, yes or no, one or zero. It does not apply to classification problems with more than two classes. And then you said information criteria. This may not be answering what you're asking, but there are some machine learning models like decision trees, where the way you build each step of the model is based on information gain, going from one layer of the model to the next layer of the model. And decision trees are very useful for classification. So that might be something that would be interesting to look into, and I can double send some resources on decision trees. That more or less answer?
Yeah.
Very cool.
I just wanted to ask another question. Could go back a slide. So I think the questions, you're giving a general high-level introduction to this part, and these questions seem to be, okay, I've got real data, I need to make real decisions, how do I dig in on specifics? And it's, so they're very much in line with this, but just going a lot deeper. And so I guess just to go a tiny bit deeper than this slide right here, but stay close to it, is if you think of these curves, and you think of how many variables you would need to specify these curves. I mean, this black curve looks vaguely like a parabola, so you could specify that with two variables. Whereas this green line, you clearly need many variables to specify it. So one example I think would maybe relate to information criteria would be you have to be putting in more information with more variables to create that green line, and so you want the pink lines for that.
Yeah, thanks for bringing that up. So that touches on a couple of interesting concepts. What I want to tackle is in. Okay. Well, we'll tackle the penalized that last. So first, so this is obviously a simplified representation. It's two-dimensional. In practice, these decision boundaries, these curves that are drawn by your model are going to be in multiple dimensions. You might have, even in that credit, that simple credit example, we had six, seven features. And it's really, one of the cool things about machine learning is that the math works in high dimensions well beyond what humans can actually visualize and handle intuitively. That's one of the really cool, really awesome things about machine learning, is the math just works. This simple parabola, as you said, you need some sort of square term in your model to get a parabola. You can do that by adding additional features, or you can do that by actually taking features you already have and just taking the square of them or the cube of them, which is a polynomial regression. Statistically, that gets a little tricky because you've got confounding variables, or you've got both x and x squared and x cubed in your model, right? Those three features aren't actually independent of each other. That's not a deal breaker. A lot of times the model will still work. Another way to think about, does this feature add additional information to my model, is like for linear regression, you can actually get an output that gives you the p-value for each, leads the p-value for each of the terms in your linear regression, and understand which ones are more statistically significant, which ones aren't, and you can actually sort of go back through and pull out the ones that are less sensitive to doing it, run your model again, and see how your model was. So depending on what type of model you have, there are different ways to figure out how many terms are actually useful. And then the last thing about it was penalizing. So another machine learning term is really important to know. We're not going to, once we've got enough time, we're not going to cover it today. The term is regularization. And it is literally penalizing models for being too complex. So we talked earlier about the cost function. So with linear regression, for example, it's just you've got a straight line and a bunch of data points, and you sum up the distances between the data points and the line, the differences, square them, that sort of be squared there. You can also add another term into that cost function that penalizes for having more terms or more complexity in your model. So it's kind of like checks and balances. You know, as you kind of turn your knob one way, you might reduce the error, your error term, your cost function, but you might actually increase it in the part of your cost function that does regularization. Because every time I can actually put up a slide on how to do that linear regression. For our purposes that here today, I guess my takeaways would be, one, different ways to understand what your optimal point is for different models. The math will help you find that. And there are ways to add additional terms to your cost function that will penalize a more complex model. And then calculus, but we'll skip that for now.
Okay.
So I think we've kind of, I think we'll understand this at this point. So even if we get the, because it is possible to get the training error down to zero, the training error is not a good, estimate of out-of-sample accuracy. That's why we do the train test split. So here's another quick thought experiment. Going back to that notion of like 80-20, 70-10, whatever. So let's assume that we do that 80-20 split. We built our model, and we got a measure of our out-of-sample accuracy. And let's see what happened if we did a different 80-20 split, just a different set of records in our 20%. Would we get different results? I heard one yes. Okay. So it seems like the answer is yes. Why? Why might we get different results?
Because now you have a different set of data to train. You have to get random. Now, let's say, when you put it in random, you have a different set of data. So that you're training data in different set of models, you start to
Yeah, exactly. So if we train a model with different data, we're going to get a slightly different model, so we're going to get slightly different results. And if there are outliers in the data, and those outliers happen to end up in one train test split and not the other, then they're going to have an inordinate effect on the model that we build. Okay. So earlier we talked about underfitting and overfitting. There's a very related concept in machine learning called bias variance trade-off. You can kind of think of this as the variance as being how well does the model generalize, and the bias as being how close, how low do we get training error. It's not a perfect analogy, but you can think of it that way. Another way to think about it is if we're shooting at targets, right? High variance means our shots are kind of all over the place. Low variance means they're tightly grouped together. Low bias means we're hitting on or around the bullseye. High bias means we're actually kind of like repetitively hitting a different part of the target. Very related concept of underfitting and overfitting. So something's still missing in terms of minimizing our generalization error. We know we need to take a train test split. We also know if we happen to take a different train test split, we get a different result. So how do we get a good estimate of generalization errors? We basically want to reduce the variance of our estimate of our generalization error. So for the stats people in the house, whenever I want to reduce the variance of something, what's something I might think about doing? I heard normalizing. What else? Yeah.
More samples.
More samples, and then what would you do with those? Okay, yeah, I have this, you know, more samples, cool. Well, so anytime I take an average, right, I'm basically going to reduce the variance. So that might be something. So what if we took a bunch of different train test splits? Right, not just one or a different one, but what if we did like 10 different splits? And then what if we trained the model on each of those different splits? Got the accuracy, which is our estimate of how well our model is going to fit a down sample, and then averaged those estimates together. That would be a lower variance estimate of how well the model is going to do. That is cross-validation. So let's dive into cross-validation. Last super important concept we're going to cover today. We've got 24 minutes to do it. So first in words, then in pictures. Basically, so how does cross-validation work? Instead of taking one train test split, we're going to take some number of different train test splits. And the idea is each time we're going to randomly, if you think about the iris data, the 150 examples, let's say that we took five different splits. Right? So I would have then five different sets that each has 30 examples. And we'd want to randomly sample the examples into those splits. Again, so we get kind of the same distribution of the classes in each split. So those five different splits are often called folds. Here's another term to remember. So if you're K-fold cross-validation, sometimes it'll be N-fold cross-validation, it means exactly the same thing. It just means that you're taking your data set and splitting it up into some number of partitions. Those partitions are called folds. No good reason. And the K in the end just means how many partitions am I splitting it up to. So if I've got five-fold cross-validation, I'm going to have five partitions of data. Again, with the iris data set, that would be 30 in each. If I'm doing 10-fold cross-validation, I'd have 15 in each. Generally speaking, it's very much just a rule of thumb. You want to use either 5, 10, or 20 folds. Because once you get beyond that, you're really not improving your cross-validation accuracy very much. So once you've split up the data set, and there are this functionality in scikit-learn to do the random sampling for you, so you don't have to write this yourself. You can learn, but you don't have to write it yourself. So once you split up the data set, then what you do is you take the first partition and you set it aside as your test data, and you train your model on everything that's left. So if I had five-fold cross-validation, I'd set aside one-fifth of my data and train my model on four-fifths. And then I would figure out how well I did, and I'd get my estimate of my generalization error, my off-sample accuracy. Then I would go back, and I would set aside the second fold, and train my model on folds 1, 3, 4, and 5. And I'd get an estimate. And then I'd set aside the third fold, and I'd train my model on folds 1, 2, 4, and 5. And I'd get an estimate. All the way through. So essentially, if you're doing five-fold cross-validation, you're training five different models. You're getting five different estimates of out-of-sample accuracy, and you're averaging those. That's going to give you a much better estimate of how good your model does out-of-sample than any one train test split alone, for the reasons we talked about earlier. It's just the random variation of data and what adds up in each split. It's also a more efficient use of your data, because before, that 20% we hold back, we only use for testing. But if you do K-fold cross-validation, you're using all of your data for training, just not all at the same time, and you're using all of your data for testing, just not all at the same time. So it's actually a more efficient use of your data. All right, what does that look like visually? Same thing when you swap through, this is just a visual picture of it. So, again, I've got 150 irises in my data set, just to make this a more concrete example. I split it up into five chunks, each of which has 30 examples, and randomly selected. The first time through, I train on the last four, test on the first one. The next time through, I hold back that second fold, train on the rest. Third time through, I hold back the third fold, train on the rest, etc. Each one gives me an estimate of my accuracy, and then my, in this case, five-fold or K-fold generalization error is just the average of those accuracies. Zach, Lucas is going to talk about scikit-learn. It has functionality that will do this for you.
Is this the way that your data be
not dependent on being able to do it.
Like if it's a high distributed data set, is there any reason that people can depend on data sets to be able to do that on the screen? What would that hurt?
The way I think about it is this. So for your features, your input data, doing cross-validation makes no assumptions about the distribution of those inputs. For your labels, for the classes that you know with your training data, you do want to be careful and make sure that each fold has approximately the same percentage of the two different classes as your overall data set. So, just to give you an extreme example, if you know your overall data set had 20% of one class and 80% of another, the way you ended up with some fold that was 50-50, then that fold would give you bad results, or misleading results when you used it.
So the way to check this to make sure you can't set up the same information to
the other class labels, yeah. And this is another visual description of the same thing we just talked about. Just generalized a little bit to k-folds. And the idea is separate your data set into some number of partitions, fold one out, train on the rest, build your model, make predictions, store the accuracy in some sort of array where you have the results of each model, and then go back and repeat, holding out each of those folds one time. Take this a step further, and just you're familiar with the term, there's also a method called leave one out cross-validation, where you essentially do the same thing, but holding out one data point each time. Obviously, that's computationally expensive. There are some models where it makes sense to do that because they're not that expensive to compute the model. And one of those is gain or fade, which we're going to talk about in a minute. So I think you've talked about the reasons of that question.
So we would immediately try to find the number of data factors. If we have data accuracy across these types of categories, so it's the same accuracy, so not quite low for one, and then we use that number one from the
people. Good question. So the question was, okay, so you get these five estimates of accuracy from your five-fold cross-validation. 10 estimates from 10 fold. If one of them is very different than the others, what do you do? And the answer there is I would go back and look at that fold and figure out if for some reason that data didn't represent, wasn't representative of the data set as a whole, because they should all be relatively close. In fact, they should actually be, the statistician might tell me for saying this, but they should all be more or less kind of like normally distributed around the estimate about a sample accuracy that you're actually trying to get. So think about it being like, oh, I'm going to average, you know, 80%, 91%, 89%. But if you got one that was, you know, if you got three that were around 88 and one that was 10, you'd want to look at the data that you used for the, you held up that one and figure out, like, okay, what's the difference?
How do you know how many different ways you want to put the data set? If you put sort of bad and others, like the example you have created as five different ways, how do you know whether five is the right number or 10?
Yep, so a couple of ways to answer that. One is there's a general just kind of rule of thumb, like a heuristic. Most people will use 5, 10, and 20. Generally speaking, you're not going to go wrong with any of those. If you want to, a little bit of a deeper answer is, well, think about how many examples you have in your data set. I mean, for most, you know, medium to large data problems, you're going to have so much data that each individual fold is going to have plenty of examples. But with this iris example, right, there's only 150 irises. So if I did 20-fold cross-validation, I would get, you know, what, 7.5 examples in each fold. That's going to introduce, not really going to introduce error, but it's not going to help you. Right? So with five-fold cross-validation, right, 30 examples each is going to be great. So you want to think about it a little bit that way. One last point that you reminded me of. Unlike the parameter tuning we talked about before, where you have certain values you can turn for each model, the number of folds you use for cross-validation is not really one of those. You're not going to get drastically different results for different numbers of folds as long as, again, you're a reasonable number of examples in each fold. So it's just not that critical. Okay. Bring it into the home stretch. We got 14 minutes and just like 3 or 4 slides. So I want to talk about what we usually, at General Assembly, we usually teach game nearest neighbors as the very first machine learning algorithm we cover. And we do this because it's relatively simple, relatively straightforward to understand. But also because it has some limitations. The Iris data set that I pointed out is a great data set to use for game nearest neighbors. So let's talk about how game nearest neighbors works. Okay, so assume we've got some imaginary data set here. Got blue dots, red dots, and green dots representing our 3 different classes. And now we've got this new example we haven't seen before represented by the gray dot. How do we figure out what class that gray dot's in? Well, in K-nearest neighbors, we consult some number of the closest neighbors, the closest data points in this data set. So we're going to pick a value of neighbor, pick a number of neighbors to consult. Let's say 3. We're going to figure out which classes those 3 closest neighbors are in. And they're going to majority vote on what class this new example is in. For this reason, we generally use an odd number of neighbors, 1, 3, 5, 7, 9. The number of neighbors to use will affect your results, and it is the one knob that you actually turn for nearest neighbors. And when we say nearest, there are different distance functions that you can use to figure out which data points are the nearest mathematically. But for k-nearest neighbors, we generally assume just normal Euclidean distance, meaning like just as it appears on this graph. Right? So x1 minus x2 is y1 minus y2 squared. Okay, so let's put this into practice. We've got another example. We want to consult 3 neighbors. We've got 2 classes, orange and blue, and we've got that new data point represented by the yellow question mark. With k equals 3 nearest neighbors, what class would you predict that new data point is? I heard a couple of blues. Anybody want to go orange?
Troublemaker.
Yes, exactly. Right. So pretty straightforward. Majority of votes says it's blue. K nearest neighbors is really that simple. You know, it takes some computation to go through and figure out the distances between each of the data points. You can actually order them and then just go down that number of entries in whatever table you create. That just gets into optimization. For a small data set, it's going to be very, very quick. Yeah.
Does this work? Does any receivers work for compositional data?
For what they're getting?
Compositional data.
What do you mean when you say compositional data?
You say you have percentages of individual things that make a group of 100 or something like that. Meaning that there's a constraint that all the individual parts have to sum to some total group, for example. And you're still trying to figure out what it is.
So the question was, if one of your features is a percentage, right, where all the different parts sum to 100, can you use that with k-nearest neighbors? I have to think about that for a second. My intuitive answer is yes. Here's why. Here's the important thing to keep in mind. K-nearest neighbors does have some restrictions. One, the features, the inputs, need to be something you can represent in a space that actually has distance as a meaningful function. So it's really difficult to use categorical inputs with k-nearest neighbors. It gives you a categorical output, but it's really not suitable for categorical inputs. Also, all of your inputs need to be standardized on the same dimensions. So for our Iris data set, we're seeing scale, right? So in our iris data set, it works really well because our four inputs are all in centimeters. But if we had one input in centimeters and another one in kilometers, then k-nearest neighbors wouldn't work very well because that distance measurement would be misleading at best. So the thing to remember with k-nearest neighbors is the distance, you need things on the same scale, and you need something you can represent the distance measurement, which you can't really do with categorical inputs. Okay. So a review of a couple of the important concepts, just to mention them again. So we talked about types of machine learning algorithms and problems. That was the supervised and unsupervised, continuous and categorical. If you can kind of keep that 2x2 structure in mind, then that's a great tool, a great framework to use to map the type of problem you have to the type of algorithm. There's lots of different algorithms that fall into that 2x2 that we didn't talk about. I'm assuming Lucas will cover some of those later today. Generalization error. So again, the goal of machine learning is to build a model that gives us predictions on data we haven't seen before. The concept of generalization is how well does our model generalize to out-of-sample data, generalize the data we haven't seen before. Talk about different types of error. Error on the training data and generalization error. And what we want to minimize is generalization error. Even if training data, even if training error is non-zero. That was that notion of underfitting and overfitting, which again you saw in that graph where we can get training error lower and lower and lower, but at some point we're actually making generalization error worse. And you want to find that minimum generalization error point. And then cross-validation, which is an industry-standard way and a very useful way to get a better estimate of your generalization error, a better estimate of how well your model is going to. And it also makes better use of your data, because you're using all the data at least once. So those are the key concepts to keep in mind as you dive into more hands-on stuff this afternoon. Again, if you I'm happy to provide the slides in PDF. What I would suggest is this, anybody who wants the slides, or if anybody has specific questions for additional learning resources, I can send you pointers to different things, just send me an email to Rob Hall, myname.ga@gmail.com. And with that, any questions? Yes?
What happened, what you should do when you get a trade off between fitting over fitting fail? Like, try a new model, the algorithm. What you do is the right moment to stop trying to fit and do something else.
So to paraphrase the question is, at what point do you just abandon ship? Okay. So that is where some of the art of data science and machine learning comes in. The way I usually approach that is if I've selected a particular algorithm, like KNN or naive phase or support vector machines, and I'm just not getting good results, and I can't figure out why, I will think back to that 2x2 matrix. I'll pick another suitable algorithm, like, you know, for classification. Maybe I haven't tried support vector machines, and I know that those work for really tough classification problems. So then I might try an algorithm and see if I can get better results with a different algorithm. You'll commonly see that in academic papers where they will compare and contrast two or three different algorithms to try to answer similar questions to see which algorithm performs best. I don't know if that fully answers your question, but if you just get to the point where it's not getting the performance and you can't figure out why, try a different algorithm that solves the same kind of problem. Other questions? All right. Cool. Well, again, feel free to email me if you want pointers to additional learning resources. I'm happy to provide that. The slides, I'll either just email you the PDF or I'll post it on GitHub, depending on whatever I feel like doing on that particular day. And of course, my posting get all the email link. I'll probably just email the slides to you. And if you have any other questions between now and lunch, feel free to come grab me. Thanks, everybody, for showing up on a Sunday morning.